This is A Deeper Listen, the show we talk with musicians about the thoughts and experiences that shape their music. I'm Emily Fox. And today we're talking with the Montreal musician Alex Henry Foster. He recently released an ambient record. It was created after an intense health crisis that left him unable to communicate verbally for a few months.
You know, my brain was slowly starting to recoup. So basically through that project, it became a bit of my rehabilitation as well.
Before getting into ambient music, Foster was in a Juno-nominated rock group called Your Favorite Enemies. I guess we're millions of faces waiting somewhere for somebody else's place to feel like home. But after his father passed away a few years ago, Foster took a trip to Morocco and ended up staying there for 2 years.
For me, it was like, okay, it's time for me to grieve my father, and also time for me to evaluate who I am as a person.
It was in Morocco that he realized he wanted to leave Your Favorite Enemies, and he started making music as a solo artist. Foster's most recent release is called Kimiyo. It's a mostly ambient record that features found sounds like sirens, thunder, and rain. It also features strings. Wind instruments. With some guitar and drum-driven rock sections. All the lyrics are sung in Japanese and tell the deeply personal stories of people Foster met in Japan when he used to travel there a lot in the mid to late 2000s. I caught up with Foster to hear about the album, but I first asked about his health issues that led into the making of this record. Those issues started while he was on a European tour with his solo project.
At some point, I wasn't like feeling very good, and which is very surprising because I'm having like a very healthy lifestyle, and touring for me, because I did it for so long, I know what it takes. So you need to be very physically and mentally prepared for that. But I had like a lot of episodes where I just feel like I was about to faint. But at the same time, it was like heat wave in Europe at that point. People were dying in the apartments. So I said, well, maybe it has a lot to do with that, because my concerts could last like 3.5 hours sometimes. So I thought it was, you know, it was based on that. So when I came back, I went to my doctor and she said, oh, you need to go to the hospital right away. And I was just laughing, and I was in Montreal. And I said, yeah, of course. No, I'm going. I have a plane to catch. I'm leaving. I'm going back home, you know, in a few hours. And she said, no, you're not. You're going to the hospital right now. So when I realized she was like, not kidding, I got a bit stressed, obviously. Got there, and they found out that I needed to have like a surgery because my heart was basically functioning at 10% of its capacity. And they were like very puzzled by the fact that I was like touring 2 days prior to get there and have all those tests. So that's it. And I had to have like double grafts, and it was very complicated. And it was supposed to be like a 5-hour surgery, finally turned out almost 10. And I had like a whole lot of problems because of that, lost a lot of blood. So I needed like transfusion, died on the table, got me back. And for 4 months after, I wasn't able to talk because I had like to have so many tubes. So I wasn't able to talk. So I found myself going from ending a tour, preparing an album, and it was supposed, 2023 was supposed to be like world tour, to doing my will before going to the hospital for a surgery. So that was a bit distressing, to say the least. And after that, it was a long, long journey to recovery. And I'm still in that process. And so, yeah, so that's where Kimiyo and the whole project kind of took place and took form, because I needed something to focus on, because I was slowly becoming very depressed. And when you don't have everything that was basically defining yourself, singing, talking, writing, I wasn't able to concentrate because I had like a microembolism in my brain. So everything was like taken away from me. And suddenly I felt very isolated, even though my friends and family were like so beautifully involved, but it was completely puzzling for them as much as it was for me, because I wasn't able to read. I wasn't able to write. I wasn't able to talk, to play music, just to focus was really, really difficult for me. So I needed to reprogram myself, because I lost so many words, just like, oh, it's a table. So for months, I wasn't able to identify very simple objects.
And you had mentioned microbolism in the brain. What does that mean?
It means that because I needed to have like plasma blood during the whole process of my surgery, that it creates like lightnings in your brain. So all the usual routes for you to think were like some of those routes were just like either like fractured or were completely fried. So in a way, if I was used to for my brain to be a highway, very very fast pace, so then my brain needed to find like all the side roads to get to the destination. So that's why when we were talking about something, it took me so much time and so much effort to keep on going and contribute to the conversation that it was like really, really strange.
How long did it last for?
That situation, what I would say, what I will call it like the my big blur was probably like 6 months, 7 months. And so I was very confused about everything. So the little moments, the little glimpses of focus that I had, I really put it in that project.
The project was initially going to be instrumental only. Foster's longtime bandmate, Ben Lumlin, who was in Your Favorite Enemies and worked with Foster on a solo project, was a big player in producing this latest record.
And most of the musical emotion was something that we were able to craft, Ben and I, as we were like, okay, this is, so I was able to sense a little bit of like the sound that I wanted to do. And so I was able to communicate with him because we've been working together for so long that we already have our own language that doesn't have anything to do with words. It's completely different when you have such a connection with someone creatively that he was able to capture what I wanted. So I would say like maybe at half of the project, I was slowly starting to be a little bit more able to directly say, okay, well, this is, let's try this. Let's make those arrangements.
Like, at what point did you start making this album throughout all of this?
I guess probably like 4 months out, when I was like after the hospital, because there was so many like appointments and medical follow-ups and everything. So that was very difficult for me, but I was slowly starting to say, okay, what I need something that I can focus on because I'm going crazy. And so for whatever reason, and that's the most beautiful thing about what I've been through. That's a silver lining, I guess. I kept on seeing like images of something that I did in Japan for like more than 10 years prior. And I had like those images, random things that were coming back to me as if, you know, my brain was slowly starting to recoup and to reorganize itself. And so basically through that project, it became a bit of my rehabilitation as well.
Foster spent a lot of time traveling in Japan starting in 2006. He toured there with his previous band, Your Favorite Enemies. He also did work there in suicide prevention and worked with Amnesty International and worked on a side film project. During his travels in Japan, Foster was told some deeply personal stories. One of those stories was told by a Japanese woman who was a fan of Foster's band. You hear her story in Foster's song, A Vessel Astray, sung by Momika Tobari.
And this young girl came to me once, and fan of the band, and she told me that what she went through, and she said, oh, your music really like helped me out through that whole process. And I was very, oh, okay, well, what happened? And so she told me that she was pretty much like wandering around, I guess typical universal theme for a teenager, but in Japanese culture, she wasn't seeing any way where she would be able to fit in. So she basically embraced a life of what she said and called as self-destruction. So she was like going out all the time and again, quitting her, like getting wasted. And it was a way for her to kind of like to slowly commit suicide. And at some point she got pregnant. She didn't want to have any of it. In circumstances where she said, well, my parents will kill me. There's absolutely no way something like that will happen. So she kind of ran away and she kept on having that type of lifestyle, partying hard, hoping that the problem will be solved by through her lifestyle. But slowly she started to talk with, you know, that what she said was like a little seed of life. And she was very frustrated at first. But it became something that was so significant for her that she was able to find purpose into it. And so through the whole journey of her life, she came to terms with so many different things, sexual abuse and everything, and what she went through in her family and in her life. And she was slowly starting to foresee a future where she would be able to do good to another little life, like she was telling me. But when she was slowly starting to be happy, she told me that she had a miscarriage because of her lifestyle, even though she stopped. And she kind of reorganized her things a little bit in a way that she was taking her health seriously because she was pregnant, lost it. And then after that, she contemplated the idea of committing suicide. But then she realized that because she foresaw her life with that child with so much clarity that it became real for her and real enough for her to say, okay, no, I will keep on going and I will keep on embracing life for whatever it is. And I will make decisions for myself to keep on embracing life on my own terms. And so that's for her. That was a big revelation, and she wanted to share that with me since my music probably like followed her around. So I was the soundtrack of her journey.
I asked Foster and his management team if I could get in touch with that woman for this story, but was told Alex hasn't been in touch with her for more than a decade, and that many folks in Japan use pseudonyms online, so she'd be hard to track down. Though I was told the band made an effort to look at old social media posts to try to find her. She was not found. But here's a song that was inspired by her story, called A Vessel Astray.
Thank you.
my final question is, you know, KEXP's, we're all about music discovery. So we would love for you to give us a music recommendation. What is a song that's not yours, a song that you love, that you're either like listening to a lot now, or a song that has made an impact somewhere along your life that's stuck with you?
I think right now I'm really going back to Glenn Branca. He's someone that has like a tremendous impact on me personally and creatively as well, that really opens up my perspective about creation. And it's funny to kind of rediscover that with a different ear. And because everything is made anew for so many reasons now. And just to rediscover that, I'm just like, well, that's crazy. And it's so close to what I'm embracing, that freedom as a person, but also as an artist. There's like an incredible, that's an emancipative perspective to it. And knowing that Glenn is like the foundation of so many bands that I like, is the foundation of like of monumental albums or movies and things like that. It goes back to this guy that nobody or so little know about. And I was talking with Lee Ronaldo from Sonic Youth, and he had the opportunity to be with Glenn, and Glenn had like a tremendous impact on Sonic Youth, obviously. And this is really what I'm rediscovering through Glenn Branca's massive and incredible body of work. And now I can see so many new bands as, you know, that kind of music comes back. And I can see where, you know, this is his legacy.
That was Alex Henry Foster. His latest album is called Kimiyo. Before you go, please do me a huge favor and subscribe to this podcast, rate it, and review it. Those little things go a long way in helping spread the word that this podcast exists, is out there, and is worthy of other people's time. You can also share an episode with a friend or your followers. That goes a long way as well. You can also help financially support this show with a monthly $6 donation. You can do that at kexp.org/deeper. And thanks for taking a deeper listen.